A warm good morning to one and all. With the blessings of our founder, Chancellor Colonel Dr. JPR, sir, I am happy to welcome you for the virtual symposium on the recent trends in aquaculture industry, jointly organized by Colonel Dr. JPR Research Park, Center for Ocean Research, and Satyabhama Institute of Science and Technology, Technology Business Incubator, in association with Ministry of Earth Science and Technology Cell. On behalf of Center for Ocean Research, we sincerely express our heartfelt thankfulness to our Honorable Chancellor Madam, Dr. Maria Zina Johnson, and our President, Sir Dr. Mary Johnson, for their constant guidance, support, and encouragement in conducting this virtual symposium. Now it's the time to welcome Dr. D. Inbagandan, Head Center for Ocean Research, and the today's guest speaker, Dr. P. Selvakumar, Senior Scientist, Technical, BMR Industries Private Limited, for the sixth day morning session of the virtual symposium. Dr. P. Selvakumar have 10 years experience in the marine biotechnology field. He completed his PhD on biofuel from marine microalgae. He worked as an assistant technical manager for Global Feeds and did postdoctoral research experience at CSIR NIST, collaborations with ICARE CMFRI. He also worked as consultant for shrimp hatchery and grow out culture farming. Presently, Dr. P. Selvakumar is working as senior scientist, Technical BMR Industries Private Limited from 2019. During his research period, nearly 200 species of microalgae have been recorded by attending frequent samplings on board of Bay of Bengal to find out the biodiversity distribution, and more than 15 species were isolated and identified through molecular taxonomy. In postdoctoral research, collaboration work was carried out with CSIR NIST and ICARE CMFRI at Thiruvananthapuram to develop an advanced technology for continuous microalgal cultivation system in raceway tank to produce mass culture for shellfishes. His findings were published in peer-reviewed international journals, conferences, and in algal biotechnology book chapter. To add a note, he visited countries like Indonesia, Denmark for conferences. Dr. P. Selvakumar also attended many national and international conferences. To a keynote, he is an editorial board member and reviewer for elsewhere journals. With immense pleasure and pride, we welcome you to give the talk on lab-to-land technology, large-scale outdoor mass cultivation of microalgae for shrimp aquaculture. Thank you, sir. The session is over to you.
Welcome, Dr. P. Silva.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. So, first of all, I would like to thank our research center and team of Dr. Inbagandan, sir. So for this, for the last five days, aquaculture, shrimp, especially in aquaculture systems, so a lot of information were gained from different organization experts in the aquaculture. So here, following that, today I am going to give my lecture on lab to land technology, large scale outdoor mass cultivation of marine microalgae for shrimp culture. So nowadays, all the people are very well familiar with the shrimp aquaculture system. But so what I am going to do thought is, so before going to cultivation, shrimp cultivation knowledge, so we should have a complete knowledge on microalgal cultivation. So one who having the microalgal cultivation system, so he can maintain the water quality as well as we can eliminate many of the contaminants, and we can maintain the surface water as well as pond bottom of the micro shrimp aquaculture system. So for that, I have attempted to find out some solution to prevent cross contaminations or some other like unwanted pathogenic bacteria in the farm system. So we can add some microalgal cultures into the pond so that the microalgae can consume all the wastages and as well as organic matters in the pond. So the pond will be very much pollution free. So in that thought, what I thought is, during my PhD period and postdoctoral research, why we cannot go for microalgal cultivation in large scale system. So the once we achieve the large scale system with good biomass, so we can add this microalgal culture into the pond so that the pond can get pollutant free. So in that thought, I have achieved some of the important points here. So my topic is lab to land technology, the large scale outdoor mass cultivation of microalgae for shrimp culture. So today I'm working as a senior technical scientist in BMR Industries Private Limited, Nellore. So all of you are well aware of BMR groups, and the BMR group has the infrastructure support of producing 6.5 million post larvae per annum and grow our farm facilities. We are having BMR Group 2,200 acres with a production capacity of 10,000 metric tons per annum. And BMR Industries had a fish processing plant located in Nellore with production capacity of 50 metric tons per day. And it has a gold storage facility with 1,500 metric tons. So as well as the feed plant capacity of BMR Industries holds two units with 1,50,000 metric tons per annum production facility in Nellore district. And the most of the India's first private broodstock multiplication center emerged in the name of BMR Blue Genetics Private Limited with the 4.5 billion capacity of post-larval production in Nellore district. So everyone knows that the India's shrimp culture is it's one of its growing protein producing industry which earns important foreign exchanges. So the shrimp production supplies is always the shrimp production supply chain in India will not get fulfilled without the various segments including hatcheries, shrimp farms, feed production as well as exports. So these all the various segments have should be participate in the straight line so that the production supply chain in India will get fulfilled. So by seeing this picture, so overall India 1,76,000 hectares are using for shrimp farming in this area. So for this 1,60,000 hectares are using for only Leptopinus banami and 14,000 hectares are using for Pinus monoda. Macropergium rosenbergii 1,760 hectares are actively participating in biomass production. So for this 91% only Leptopinus banami only occupying the shrimp farming areas in India. So next coming for the annual production compared to 2018 to 2019, so there are 31% hike in annual production. Yes, you can see here almost USA 2,82,000 metric tons and China 1,59,000 metric tons and US 73,702 and Japan almost 40,000, Vietnam 32,000. So likewise almost, so today production 8 lakh metric tons we have reached on 2019. So then the next slide we can see the increasing trend of the shrimp exports from 2015 to 2020. So here for the span of the past 4 years, the production volume and export volume has been raised with numeric in value of double. So 6,60,000 and 7,879 the metric tons were exported, and while seeing the 2015 only 4 lakh metric tons. So it is almost double within the span of four years. So always the shrimp exports have had continuous growth over the past decade with the new year on year increasing in volume. So the average generated revenue is $5 billion, the result were obtained from the Ministry of Commerce and Industry Government of India. So everyone knows the important importance of shrimp cultivation in India. So how much volume we are producing and how much volume we are exporting into the other nations. So obviously we can say India is number one. So in that, Andhra Pradesh is known to be a India shrimp culture hub. Yes. Andhra Pradesh having 6 states with unitary territories of India, adjoining the Bay of Bengal with a coastline of 974 km with the continental shelf area 23,000 square meters in the east coast of India. Yes, we can see this map here. So this map projecting the east coast of India, especially in the area of Visakhapatnam. So doing my PhD research, so these points, you can see here the points number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 to 14. So it's cover one Visakhapatnam area seashore only. So these locations are almost, we can say, very rich microalgal population, population of microalgae in this east coast of India, especially in Visakhapatnam zone. The major reason is many industrial areas are occupied with the Visakhapatnam coastal area. So always in the year overall, whole the year, we can get good sufficient nutrients, nutritional factors in the offshore water of the Visakhapatnam coast. So in this way, the beauty of this one is surface current, this treating the coast move in the northerly direction during the part of the year and the reverse opposite direction during the rest of the year. So what is mean is, so we can get the surface current always moving north to south, so we can get a good upwelling system. So even though the influx water, sea water influx or rain water influx very low in particular locations, so water upwelling is happening. So the upwelling happening times, all the nutrients sedimented settled in the bottom at most coming to the surface water of the sea, so that the microalgae population is very rich by consuming these natural nutrients, so which is diluted from the effluent waters of urban and industrial areas. So we all of know that the phytoplankton, yes, phytoplankton is nothing but the plant, we can say that it's always a drifting organism. So drifting organism is nothing but floating organism. So it's always float on the waves, based on the waves. It's almost always in single cell. So it's basically based on the marine food chain, base of the marine food chain. So responsible for biological carbon form. So the biological mediator in pumping of carbon from the surface ocean to surface to the ocean interior. So we all know that the microalgae produce more than 50% of oxygen in atmosphere. So we can characterize some of the groups in here in as a phytoplankton. So diatoms, coccolithophorids, dinoflagellates, cyanobacteria, and prochlorococcus. So each and every diatoms and coccolithophorids having a important ecological roles. So for example, diatoms having a having very good silica silica bodies, it's poorly crazed, and we can say the coccolithophorids always having a small calcium carbonate plates, and the dinoflagellates also has a motile volume, some are bioluminescence, so it always responsible for the red tide. And coming for the cyanobacteria, its blue green bacteria can form a chains and fix a nitrogen cases, that is very important here. And the fluorococcus is the one site of cyanobacteria, smallest phototroph by the size of 0.6 micrometers. So it's most abundant on the earth is prochlorococcus. So the always the recorders say that the type of cyanobacteria is most abundant on the earth. So everyone knows well. So as I said, the nitrate, nitrite, phosphate, silicate in the nutritional mode. So we can categorize as the two carbon sources, one is inorganic or organic. So coming for energy sources, sunlight and chemicals, photoautotrophs, photoheterotrophs, hematoautotrophs, hemoheterotrophs. So these are the major four nutrient modes which is playing in the vital role for nutrition to the marine microorganisms, especially for microalgae in the sea. So what we have done for during my PhD research, so onboard samplings have attended. So for the purpose of to know the seasonal and spatial variations, where we can get a good microalgae with good PUFA rich content microalgae. So for that, for the searching hunt, we have get into the sea by fishing vessel, mechanized boat. So by using this boat, we entered into the sea as offshore of the waters, and we have collected 14 sites, and we have collected water samples. So these water samples are preserved and with the cooling condition with ice bugs, we have transported into the laboratory, and we have analyzed water quality as well as the phytoplankton checklist. So see how lovely of the phytoplankton diversity, full of phytoplankton diversity in Bay of Bengal, Visakhapatnam coast. So we can identify these phytoplanktons in microalgae identification for aquaculture, it was 1990, and identification marine phytoplankton Thomas 1977. So these two books are very important to especially for diatom species and dinoflagellate species. So how lovely these pictures. So during my PhD period, I have used the coral sea microscope to capture these species. So while I'm seeing this picture, I always get enthusiasm to work with microalgae in sea resources. So finding out my results, so we have 2 years continuously worked. So water temperature reached almost 29.48 degrees Celsius, and the salinity 30 ppt, and pH rise 8.19 pH recorded, and the dissolved oxygen is 7.02 ml per liter, and chlorophyll A, B, C in the concentration 3.46, 2.76, 2.80 respectively in the pre-monsoon period. So the pre-monsoon period indirectly saying that so good abundant tropic, we are living in the tropic country, we are having a very good sunlight system. So sunlight and sun energy very much important to important for microalgae generation time, increasing generation time. So coming for nutritional values, the nitrate and phosphate, so you can see in the monsoon period 0.2 mg to 0.2 ppm is very good in nitrate value in ocean, I mean offshore of the waters. So monsoon period here, I have recorded in the values in the monsoon period. So the reason behind that is rainy season water influx will be high in the seashore area. So that nitrate value and nitrate value both are obtained good in monsoon period. So the phosphate is observed in post monsoon period, nothing but just next to the monsoon period. So that we have attained almost 0.8 ppm per liter with the concentration, and silicate also 0.3 ppm per liter concentration. So these nutritional values based on nitrate, phosphate and silicate, so microalgae can survive without breaking the chain. So long year we can get the microalgae from that seashore. So that's the thing I am here mentioning, especially for microalgae. So nitrate, phosphate, silicate, these four is very important to grow the microalgae in laboratory concern, laboratory site, as well as shallow tanks in open air system. So based on these parameters, we have formulated some microalgae culture media formulation. So based on that, we have grown microalgae in very large systems, including indoor and outdoor and open air tank also. So the upcoming slides will show these photos of all those things. So qualitative and quantitative abundance of microalgae, almost 161 species were recorded in first year, and the second year also almost 160 in period of 3 months in time. So the divisions covers Acrophyta, Dinophyta, Cyanophyta, Chlorophyta, Eclogenina, Heptophyta. So these four, six divisions were playing a very important in microalgae diversity in Bay of Bengal area, Bay of Bengal coastal system. So coming for the characteristics and the both sampling series, so we have recorded almost 12 classes with the family of 59 genus, 91 genus, species around 191 species with give a percentage of 100% of the species. So most of the microalgae phytoplanktons are centrales, pineals, dicotyledonaceae and monodicotyledonaceae. So almost 40%, 25% and 1% and 0.2% coming for the characteristics of microalgae in both sampling here. So what I have done is, so next, so very very rich abundance of phytoplanktons available in our water. So why we can't go for isolation process, why we can attempt to grow indigenous microalgae which may be useful to useful for shrimp aquaculture with high PUFA content. So in that attempt, we have gone for some isolation process in this by using petri dishes and slant systems and some micro well systems. So we have obtained seawater and filtered through different vessels. So to eliminate the macro organisms like egg or something like zooplanktons and some debris. So we can eliminate all those things by filtering 100 micron mesh and following that 60 micron, 40 micron, 20 micron, 5 micron, and even 2 micron. So different kind of meshes are used to filter the water and the filtered water properly used for cultivation. So we have not done with going for inoculation. So directly we are using the filtered seawater and adding some to enrich the seawater. So by adding small quantities of nitrate or nitrate or phosphate silicate, so different setup we have implemented. So in that we have achieved many microalgae, unicellular and cellular many microalgae we have isolated. So the isolated microalgae were cultured in valence medium for especially Histidiomycetes, Trichomycetes, and the BG medium, the BG 11 medium for cyanobacterium species, and the F2 medium for Carcinomycetes and Bacillomycetes. So these inoculums were developed after 7 days. The inoculum for use for indoor tank was obtained from the laboratory. The culture which were scaled up in the ship-based station, starting from 500 ml to 2 liter in immersion clay flask to final culture volume of 20 liter in aerated transparent 20 liter transparent PET jars. So the PET jars are full of surface are fully transparent, so that whatever the light gradients we are giving is directly absorbed by microorganism, and it will grow very fast, and the division rate and the generation time will be minimized. So see here, isolated organic microalgae culture work. Isolated and kept for separately for maintaining the stock cultures. So the stock cultures were successfully obtained as axanic, and the axanic cultures were scaled up to 2 liter and 5 liter and 10 liter and 15 liter, and even we have done in shallow pond water system. So see how beautiful our isolated different strains, and these all the strains are very axanic. Some of the diatoms having 1 or 2% contamination with some other phytoplankton. So this is not a very big issue. So while we are using into the aquaculture system, we no need to consider about these small kind of contaminations. So these isolated microorganisms were microalgae were undertaken to the molecular taxonomy to find out species level. So here, 23S rRNA sequence are used to identify the microalgae, because the large subunits of rRNA gene has higher evolutionary rate than does the short subunits of rRNA genome. So for that purpose, we have carefully handled the molecular taxonomy with the repeated attempted. With the repeated attempted, we have obtained very good microalgae with the axanic system without any contamination. So and after isolation, that one we have done for some molecular identification purpose. So phylogenetic analysis we have done. So here these systems shows nanoclones, gadetena strain number 1 and 2, and the trichotinum, oocystis, salmeria, vulgaris, chlorella vulgaris, these are 1 and 2 cyanococcus species. So these major things were coming growing well without having any contamination. Why? Because the unicellular microorganisms have a unique nature that the cell division state very high, so that these microalgae will get bloomed very fastly, so that unstable diatoms are eliminating from the culture system. So to identify this, the genetic distance among the taxa, the phylogram representing rate of evolution of organism, where the number of character changes in the protein is directly proportional to this branch length of this class. So these glands are the one species number 10, 1 and 2, and the near species was Pyodactylum, Trichoderm, and the next is showing that Oocystis solitaria. So these branches, the nearby evolutionary relations showing that the sequence similarity is severe as evidence for structural and functional conservation, as well as to represent the evolutionary relations between the sequence. So whatever the sequence we are giving, so we can get the we can get the knowledge of the relationship between the sequence, as the sequence nothing but the species of the microorganisms and different strains. So here 23 rRNA gene sequences deposited in the NCBI. So almost 8 sequences were submitted into National Center for Biotechnology Information with access to numbers of following slides. And so once we find out the particular species with having an axanic mode, axanic conditions, the culture system is scaled up to large scale system. So coming in this, for this the screening, so we have adopted this methodology in the indoor system. So always indoor system will give good concentration of microalgae. So always good concentration of microalgae in mass volume can be used as a inoculum to the outdoor mass culture. Then only the culture strongly, constantly maintain without having any contamination. So for that indoor cultivation system, 150 micromole photons per square per second, irradiation are given, and salinity maintained for 34 ppt with the pH of 8.3. So the aeration was provided by using aerator approximately 0.5 per liter ambient air per minute, and the growth kinetics were analyzed by using Udall protocols, and the biomass and liquid productivity will be detected by already published papers by Selvakumar and Umar 2015, and the biodiversity and the GCMS and the GC analysis for fatty acid profile of microalgae, which is very important role for to choose the candidate of the microalgae for aquaculture system. And the basic alignment, the local alignment steps tools done with NCBA with multiple sequence are aligned using cluster X tool. And the distance and clustering with neighbor joining method were performed by using 3.69 sorted package, and the out-tree generated consent programs used by using Victree E1.4.2 sorted. So why this bioinformatics very important here is, without knowing this one, we cannot get the identification confidence. So by using these all the tools, give a good clarity of the microalgae species. So that we have used adopted this methods and materials and method. So in this slide, so as I said, we have developed a very good system in indoor culture. So these indoor cultures were shifted to the outdoor as an inoculum, and this culture was developed within 2 or 3 days. So as I said that microalgae, very important one is sunlight. So we are in tropical country, we have a sufficient abundant sunlight source. So by using the sunlight source, microalgae, unicellular microalgae, if we can able to inoculate with actinic culture, surely we can get a very good mass culture system in outdoor. See, these are many aquaculture species, microalgae species are differently in time between we have cultivated in direct open pond. So after that we have harvested this biomass by adding some chemical flocculants. So these why we have used this system of chemical flocculants I harvest the microalgae. So at the time I worked while doing my research, I focused on biofuels. So how much the liquid factors will be we can obtain from this biomass. So that purpose I have harvested the microalgae chemical bioclan. So very good quantity, almost 0.5 grams per liter also we have harvested in the outdoor system. So these rates are also different kind of microalgae strains in different times. So and this after once you added the aluminum sulfate as chemical flocculant, so all the microorganisms will go into settle down. So the process what is happening here is, so once you add aluminum sulfate, so automatically the pH of the culture will get fluctuate. So the once the culture fluctuate, pH fluctuate happened in the culture, so automatically all the microorganisms present in the water column will be settled down. So by using this small technique, we have harvested the biomass, and the harvested biomass was subjected to biochemical analysis as well as fatty acid lipid extraction. And after the lipid extraction for fatty acid in transesterification, the transesterified oil was subjected for GCMS analysis to find out the fatty acid profiles. So here, small area we have used to cultivate the microalgae in the lab itself. So here these upcoming sites are source open pond shallow water, how much we can get biomass. So that kind of trials we have attempted. So in that trials we achieved very good very good biomass concentration per liter. So this one. So we have constructed this Eden pond with HDP line. So in this, an annual average yearly irradiation of sunlight is 4.08 kW per meter square per day in 2012 while I'm working. So obviously today as a 2020, temperature might be rising. The square open pit ponds with surface area of 196 meters square and the depth of 0.6 meter were constructed with four sidewalls performed by Eden dikes and bottom lines with HDP seeds. So once the microalgae culture need to be successfully get into a very good biomass concentration, so we should go for some HDP line seed Eden ponds. So then only if the contamination or cross contamination occurs or something happens while in the culture system, we can go for cleaning or we can remove all the system and we can rebuild it next time. So that means we have attempted 4 to 5 times to success this this manner. So on the large scale biomass production system, once the microalgae having with high concentration, the high concentration microalgae were carried out with 20 liter pet jars into the shrimp culture ponds. In there, we have set up the system so where we can grow microalgae with very good biomass concentration in open air pond. So culture media concentration is volume medium concentration we have only given, but not all the compounds are added into the culture media. So basically, we have added only nitrate and phosphate and silicate system only. So here, the nutrient medium increases what was added to develop the culture. So once the inoculation was done, within 3 to 4 days, we can get very good microalgae concentration in the open air system. So here, we have isolated some indigenous chlorella algae. So this was isolated from our Bay of Bengal coast only. The indigenous species were taken up to this shallow pond open air system. So in this shallow pond open air system, we got a very good concentration. The concentration of biomass as well as and the aerial productivity and generation growth kinetics and biochemical composition. So everything we can share next upcoming slides. And this biomass production in hatcheries. So here we are tested in 10,000 metric ton quantity simming tanks. So we wanted to get assessment of the different areas. So the particular areas can and particular systems can give a higher concentration of microalgae. So 200% we have focused on only higher concentration of microalgae to obtain the biomass. So once we achieved very good results in the hatchery system, the hatchery released microalgae also dewatering, and we obtained this biomass. This obtained the biomass was same, so we have screened for fatty acid profiles. So these harvested biomass were declining dewatering from the surface water. So after the biomass settled into the bottom, these surface water will be decanted, and the decanted after decanting, this obtained bed biomass was washed with water, tap water, and dried in not in the direct sunlight but in the shade sunlight. So after getting the biomass, again we have screened for best pupa content polyunsaturated system with candidate microalgae. So here some studies I have found out that so the different concentration nitrogen source in culture media, the culture media nitrate concentration can fluctuate the fatty acid profiles of the particular microalgae. So luckily eicosapentaenoic acid 14% of EPA we have obtained with the concentration of 0.05 grams per liter united in the culture media. So as well as this is species specific, that's what always microalgae biotechnology work. So whatever the profile you're getting from individual species, so it always depends on the species. So here fatty acid, total fatty acid 17.7% total fatty acid to achieve, and the while increasing sometimes while increasing the concentration also can reduce the fatty acid in the same fatty acid profiles. So for example, see 0.1 to 0.125 grams per liter concentration of nitrate can reduce the total amount of polyunsaturated in tetracellulose graceless species, and the platymonas canulata species it was around 2 when 0.075 grams per liter concentration of nitrate can reduce to just 2% of total polyunsaturated fatty acid. So that's what, whatever the microalgae we are growing, we should undertake the laboratory system, and in this laboratory system we should have some experiments. So based on the experiments which the value are getting very good, so based on that parameters we should go with outdoor mass cultivation. So obviously we can get very good polyunsaturated fatty acids in isolated microalgae. And here we have conducted some studies with the different type of carbon sources, those spectros and spectros models. Here also the fatty acid is giving 7.2 with the glucose concentration, 2 grams per liter concentration. So nowadays microalgae, all the tests are done with microalgae biotechnologist people, especially for carbon sources, nitrogen sources. The same is now applicable into the aquaculture system. So nothing but people are using fermentation to control the pH in the pond system. So in that people are using carbon sources. So using carbon sources also we should know the proper concentration. So then only we can get good microalgae population with good acres of pentonic acid. So based on this we can cultivate the microalgae. So the ones the microalgae which were adding to the culture pond as a inoculum, so that microalgae should have a capability to grow in all the atmosphere. So as well as it should have a very good acres of pentonic acid, DHA, locus of hexonic acid. So these two acids are very important. So these two acids are very important and high in rich. So that microalgae are playing very good vital role in hatchery system. So once the larval layering and all the stages are completed, so microalgae as a live feed they're giving into the nursery to hatchery system. So and so these tables are showing the fatty acid profiles in the nitrate concentration. And this table shows the carbon different concentration. And coming for the growth kinetics like in open air system. So in this open air system, many people can think that so in this open air system may get contamination or get fluctuating parameters. We cannot control the system to get good biomass like that. Some people well educated people also as a farmer they are thinking like that. So not like this. If you once we can have a trial with an open air system, surely we can get the microalgae with big large scale biomass. So that the large scale biomass culture may use it to pond system. So the pond system may arrest all the contaminants from even ammonia or sulfur dioxide, so whatever the things is there. So the microalgae can consume as organic matters in this pond, bottom of the pond, so that the pollutant free atmosphere can be given into the sim. So here the aerial production 30 almost 40 grams per meter square per day per meter square 40 grams we can get as a dry biomass. And the generation time 1.87 and the division per day 0.5. So we have obtained maximum amount is 0.98 grams per liter concentration, and the initial concentration is 0.05 grams. So likewise, we have conducted four different experimental trials. So in that, we have achieved 0.98 grams per liter concentration. And so far, I have talked about the microalgae which can isolated from seawater and isolated microalgae cultivated in laboratory level and laboratory level large scale microalgae. Culture may use it to the outdoor mass culture, so in open air pond. So open air pond water, culture may use it to aquaculture system. So that's the flow I have given so far. And so what I have done in this particular study is the multi-population microalgae. See, why I have attempted with the multi-population microalgae? It's very simple. See, once we have done water pumping from the seashore, and the seashore water will be passed to the sedimentation tank. The sedimentation tank filled with the different type of nets to eliminate all the contaminants. So even though if we do all this thing and finally do chlorination and finally do water treatment, everything, and final within 2 or 3 days, you may find this multi-population microalgae. So likewise, I have set up this setup with large scale culture system. So in this, we have not added anything. So means the directly what are the microalgae present in the obtained, pumping water source, that microalgae only can be get blooming. So in that season, so water intaking system is there, no? So particular location, we should go to analyze the population of microalgae. So now we are going to take this water from the particular area. So the area should be, the water quality as well as microalgae also need to be checked. So the ones we have find with some, what you can, blue-green algae like flagellates, blue-green algae with long stems, we can eliminate the water, and we can choose some other location to intake the water for aquaculture system. So blindly we have chosen one location. So we have pumped the water from the near seashore area. So this pond is adjacent to the local estuary. So that estuary adjoining water mouth. When the high tides occurs, the water inflows into the estuary. So first the river flow will overflow, the water will enter into the sea. So this is the mouth zone. This mouth zone we have selected, and we have taken the water from this location. So pumped into the water directly without doing any treatment. So within a week, full phytoplankton blooms. So overall, all the phytoplankton are based to diurnal species. So here, so these are the multi-population microalgae species were found in the water where we have taken for aquaculture, shrimp aquaculture. So these waters having some amount of cyanobacterium species and some oscillatory species. So these two species always will do some disturbance in the culture system. So they may not get constantly, we cannot get the constant growth of the microalgae in the water surface. So the water surface once fluctuates with some other parameters difference here. So these blue-green algae will form the water surface, and it will protect the sunlight enter into the bottom. So once the protection will happens, controlling the sunlight fall into the bottom. So obviously these microalgae will bloom heavily, and the bottom will get always contaminated. We cannot treat with any probiotic and as well as any microalgae growth. So while taking the water, these two microalgae, blue-green algae is there or not, we should ensure with the water intake system. So these are the diatoms. Mostly diatom species were checklisted with this water intake systems. So some of blue-green algae, Lingia, Oscillatoria, Parnopodium, Cyanotropis, Trichodesmium, Cyanopis, so all the blue-green algae is there. So once we found this, so based on this composition, we can use the filter water. We can use the water filter and we can go for water treatment like chlorination. So whatever you do, blue-green algae, you cannot eliminate. So I mean, in aquaculture system, people are giving good concentration to eliminate the contamination. No, chlorine concentration always people will give only less only. So and the technicians also may not have a good skill in a particular chapter and area. So people also will get fired. So blue-green algae is there. So we can eliminate with some filtering systems, and we can go for good concentration of chlorination. And after dechlorination, we can use the water for larval inoculation. And coming to here, after completion of sail out tank open air systems, we achieved a very good biomass concentration with a very good pupa concentration of microalgae. So that microalgae seems we have used as candidates for aquaculture. And these day and after that, why we cannot go? Why we can still we can eliminate the microalgae? Some other associated bacteria or something like blue green algae. So we can control with the raised tanks in continuous culture. So we can try with this raised tank continuous culture to eliminate this kind of contamination also. So for this, we have set up a very good advanced technology instruments for raised tank setup. So we have used with high sensitivity pH and DO electrode to monitor online monitoring for real time data management. And we have used gas mass flow controller for CO2 injection and automated dosing pump for addition of ammonia, nitrate and phosphate used was controlled by electronic timer on and off. And we have used 1 HP motor attached to the gearbox for paddling operation. So here the raised tank continuous culture, automated nutrient screening dosage pump with timer digital with the high sensitivity sensor for the sensors with the transmitter, low mass flow controller with PID controller used for controlling parameters and the real time data monitoring in the raised pump. So people, we can ask why this kind of very sophisticated system, so the sophisticated system we can implement it in the aquaculture systems or not. So always we look on protection cost. So if you use these systems, protection cost also will be. So what I can say is, so these are all one-time investment. So now we can say small farmers may not have this kind of continuous culture system. Carpet sites like more than 100 acres or more than 50 acres people. So who people are looking with very advanced technology more, that people can use this tank, raised tank to contain some microalgae. So as I said, microalgae is very important, play a very vital role to boosting the shrimp health. So for that we have chosen this system. So nothing, what I'm saying is, whatever the things you are giving is, it should make animal as healthy as well as rich protein efficiency system. So if we use this kind of systems, we can develop a very good microalgae for long time. So we can get the inoculum from this raised tank, and we can add weekly once or 10 days once into the pond system. So we can almost avoid some of the contaminants, and we can reduce the production cost also. So in this slide, I'm showing a real-time monitoring system. It's a transmitter, it's metallo. So we have used two sensors, high-sensitive sensors. So one for pH and another one for DO. So you can see the first one, 8.45 is pH, and next one is 29.4 degrees Celsius temperature. So on the second probe, 9.1 ppm oxygen DO level is, and 29.3 degrees Celsius in is temperature in raised tank. So this is the setup. The setup has been set up by the help of CSIR NIST collaboration with ICMR, ICAR, CMFRI. So here these two pumps are playing a very important role. So one for nitrate, another one for phosphate. So automatic dosing pump, this automatic dosing pump will maintain the concentration of nutrients in the raised tank very constantly. So for example, what we do is directly we'll add nutrients. I mean we can add 100 grams of 100 kgs of nutrients into the dumping into the water system. So at the time, what happened, luckily if we have a very good flagellate microalgae, it's the unicellular, that is, it will give a favor result. If if nitrate concentration are some more high with the phosphorus, what happens, dinoflagellates species will get dominant and the everything will be collapsed. So then we no need to add, we no need to give direct doses into the water, raised system, so that we can directly dilute the nutrient system per ml, per minute per ml, or 0.5 ml per minute. So like that we can adjust with the timers, so that so always the nutrients level in the raised tank is constant for long period. So they, second wise are 20 seconds, 30 seconds, one drop, or 60 seconds, one drop. So like that we can manipulate the program. So based on that, the frequent adjusted doses are always injected into the raised system. So here we can see the closer view of the system. So in this system, as I said, raceway pond with one HP motor gear, only one paddle wheel. Here two sensors are attached. So you can see this picture, the left one. So two sensor, high sensitivity sensor were implemented. So the sensor, sensor connected into the transmitter. So the transmitter always give values to this box. So here these dose pumping with the timer will always give a correct concentration into the raised tank to maintain the concentration of nutrients, especially nitrate or phosphate or silicate, whatever it is. And so we have developed some standard operational procedure. So what is the meaning of creating this processor is, so whatever the thing in aquaculture system what we are doing, it should always work with farmer level. So in that motto, so simple, nothing but, so 6 o'clock we can add the paddle wheel system, and 9 o'clock we can add bottom cleaning by manually. One or two days if you do bottom cleaning manually, we can avoid the film formation. And the after 10 o'clock, just a harvest time with the 400 liter from the culture tank and add 200 cellular seawater or raw seawater, and microscopic observation 10 o'clock, and 10 to 6 nutrition doses function to work for 4 hours per daily, and the every 2 or 3 days 15 grams silicate should be added, and 10:30 we can adjust this operational procedure. So simply even the layman also can get knowledge. So while showing the pictures, it's a very big technology, it can confuse. So having a very good knowledge in particular technology can only operate the system. So that likewise people may think, so no. So based on this time precision, they can operate all the systems. So all the systems come into our mobile, or we can use into the desktop or laptop, so that we can control the parameters. So how I can control the parameters, I will say. So the process is nothing but, so we can use 5 micron net, phytoplankton microalgae net, phytoplankton net with 5 micron. We can filter the seawater, so we can maintain the velocity of the pond constantly. The proper velocity should be maintained by using paddle wheel. And here we have attempted 5 different trials to undertake to achieve the diatom pools. So mostly this work was carried out in the seashore area of Arabian Sea. So here diatom pools, Nitia and Anthora, both species are giving a very good blooms. So within the 2 months we have obtained very good Nitia and Anthora blooms, and these blooms were maintained more than 5 months without any microalgae contamination. So here the nutrient concentration in the tank was maintained properly, and the ratio of 1:13. The phosphate was 1:13. Phosphate nitrate concentration fluctuated by the experimental results, and we have adapted into the raised system. So the successfully carrying out by harvesting 30% of culture every alternate day. So the once this culture was harvested by 30% days, and we can add 30% top up to the alternate day. So constantly you can maintain the concentration of the microalgae. And that IMCA cone shows 8 to 10 ml concentration biomass, and it is settled for 1000 ml of the volume. So the culture temperature fluctuated from 25 to 33 degrees Celsius. So at the times, based on the temperature, 25 to 35 degrees Celsius, culture temperature observed to fluctuate. And the maintaining salinity with frequent harvest on the top of the 22 ppt to 24 ppt, it's rising. So why people can say within 4 or 5 days in open tank, salinity may shoot up. So here salinity is not shoot up. Why, we can ask some questions. So here I am saying 32 ppt to 34 ppt. How it is possible? So always obviously it will rise up to 40. So no issue. So daily regular wise, alternate day or regular, we are withdrawn from 30% from the raised tank and adding 30% into fresh water, sea water. So even though if you are doing the same practice, we can control the ppt also. And the fluctuation, pH fluctuation is 8.5 to 9, and these 9, so when I say, so the temperature rise in the time of 9 o'clock to 11 o'clock, the pH always goes high. So at the time, just for 20 or 30 seconds, we can add adjust by carbon dioxide cylinder. If we give some small amount of food for 20 seconds by adding carbon dioxide cylinder, we can bring down the pH to normally 8.5. So DO is found to be between 6 to 20 ppm. People can ask how the DO will reach 20 ppm. Surely it will give a suit up. Why I'm saying? So microalgae itself releases DO. So I said 50% of atmospheric oxygen is from the ocean by the microalgae. So isn't it? So at the time, so here we can accept that 25 ppm of DO will be noted in the raised tank system. So that means such a high concentration of microalgae are obtained growing in the raised tank. See, here you can see the first trial with the natural phytoplankton scaler. So initial day, just 8 pH, 34 ppt, 9 ppm DO, 32 degrees Celsius culture temperature. That's it. The raw seawater was filtered by using 40 micron net. And we have added 4 grams per meter square. So here nothing but meter square will give 300 liters. So almost 10 meter square means 1,200 liters capacity tanks. So we are adding a concentration 4 grams per meter square. So meter square 400 grams per meter square means the 4 grams per 300 liters. So that should be very clear here. So and the phosphate 0.3 grams per meter square. So ratio is 1:13 ratio. So beginning started, we have initial stage, we have started with this ratio. Other than we have not added any silicate at all. So the source water itself has a very good silicate concentration, so that we have added additional silicate. So the fifth day of culture, the color developed and the few numbers are noted with two species. So at the time, 0.4 pH is increased for 4 days. So only pure water, you know, so pure water always do around 8 to 8.5. So while I am taking 0.4 pH increase, just for 4 days, nothing happened in the raised system. So that is the meaning here. So so the DO was 4 ppm rise to 13 ppm. So 2 ppt increased from 32 ppt. So what is that? So it means microalgae slowly getting bloom. That is the highlight here. So the temperature also covered 28 to 32 degrees Celsius in culture temperature. So these all the parameters can keep the microalgae for long period. So on the 8th day, the good color developed, and we have found out the Nishia Colostrum and with few flagellates. So what happens the 8th day, 5th day, no? So what low concentration, why we cannot add some more silicate? So while I'm checking the silicate, the water source, the culture water source, very, very minimum ppm. That's what I have added some more. 3 grams, I mean 3 grams of silicate. So the ones we have added after the 7th day, the 8th day noted with noted with very good bloom. So these bloom color will change. So this all this microalgae due to addition of silica, Clostridium bloom equal to green algae. So in the time I added, no. So 5th day again I have added 1 gram of 1 gram per meter square nitrate concentration. So the meaning the consortium should be equally followed. Otherwise, the ones the microalgae of Clostridium get spoiled or crashed, so our tank should not be empty. So that's what I have equally maintained the green flagellate algae also. So by practicing 300 liter harvest every alternate day and 300 liter top up with the same volume of water into the raised system to maintain the constant of culture without having any contamination. So without having any contamination, it's meaning we are not saying that bacteria free microalgae. You see, it's open system. So obviously associate microalgae will associate bacteria will be in the culture system. So if it is high in the microalgae or zooplankton and some other particles, if with high carbon sources, we can say that as a biofloc. So this is only purely 95% pure microalgae culture system, which can help us help us inoculum for shrimp aquaculture system. Sorry. So in the 12th day, Naviclo also suited to come up. But dominant to green algae. So the silicate concentration is worked well, and the silicate concentration is consumed well by this diatom species. So the green algae atmosphere to grow the green algae chance was that lost. So that the green algae where we have seen small amount of green algae flagellates, so that microalgae got eliminated. So again, we have added 6 grams per meter square on the 8th day, achieved almost 80% of diatom species in culture time. So almost green algae arrested due to nitrate and phosphate concentration. So silicate concentration, we have given a good concentration of silicate, and we have reduced the nitrate concentration in the water system. So the green algae got crushed. So why? Because the natural water itself, we are getting some microalgae. Why we cannot maintain this microalgae for long time? So that is the concern. So we can say, instead of growing unstable microplankton, phytoplankton as a diatom, we can, why we cannot go with green algae? Okay, we can go. But there's something we are getting some interesting factors, no? With growing with some diatoms. So mostly diatom species cannot be cultivated in the laboratory system. So favorably our raised tanks worked well, so that we have cultivated this diatom species. And the 14th day, Naviclo, Nishia and Clostridium and Amphora also species also frequently getting domination by addition of silica. So you can see, so some unstable phytoplankton, phytoplanktons in diatom species, unstable few concentrations will get crushed. So that by using this net by manually once a day, we can scoop. So once you like that, you can scoop means the surface floating micro phytoplanktons like diatom, we can collect from these raised tank, and we can put into some other pond. So here, salinity rise will see, here, the time, day of 14, salinity rise to 40. So sunlight is very good, almost 2 lakhs light irradiation was noted in this particular site. So here, on the day 12th or 14th and day 12, salinity rise to 40. So the salinity rise means high concentration rate, and so some other phytoplankton may not be disturb the cultures. So the high concentration of PPR, high salinity concentration waters will not entertain all the microalgae. So it will give the place to survive the microalgae, the phytoplankton which have can ability to survive in 40 salinity. So for example, we can say Dunalilla more than 40 ppt it can survive. So if I maintain the pond in 40 ppt condition, surely I will get the Dunalilla. There's no doubt at all. So Dunalilla species also small amount of fungi, very few cells are found in the water. So on 16th day, amphora species got domination, and the colostrum also found to be equal number of both. So these two species are belongs to Nagula only, Nagula family only. So this is not called a contamination. So it's a good source of phytoplankton with the dietary species. We can use this culture to our aquaculture system. And the 20th day, very thick cultures and the cell division stages also started. And as I said, the amphora species also started to get multiplication. So at the time, the 6 ml out of 1000 ml concentration are obtained in IMCA phone observation. So 30th day, so I have checked with, so what will happen after 30, just I blindly let them go like that, this is the culture. On the 30th day, very clearly the all the phytoplankton got settled down. So water column almost 80% is free. 80% is free. So all the phytoplankton, so very big flagellates, I mean very very big cells, 200 mm, 300 mm microalgae, phytoplankton, diatoms, all are settled down. So we have collected the biomass and we gone through the microscope observation. So in that, the consortium species are pointed out. So what I said is, once the biomass gets settled down, the surface water or mid of the water started to grow green microalgae. So the sufficient nitrogen and nitrate sources are available in the source, surface and the middle column water. So once the diatom species are getting settled down, green algae started to develop. So these water were surface water were picked out from separately in syntax tanks. So we have observed. So green flagellates, so might be tetracellinis gracilis species, might be this one. So there are four flagellates found in here. So the first day, fourth day, sixth day, the culture become a very good healthy. So so these microalgae also stable for almost 10 to 15 days. So after this attempted, again we have thought, sir, why we cannot go with available strains already in our laboratory? So mixed mass culture, isocretins, ketogenes, nanochlorophyll, added as 20% nanochlorophyll, and found that the mixed culture 0.3 grams per liter concentration within the 36 hours. By consuming 28.5 grams nitrate and 7.5 grams phosphate under 200 volt per meter square light irradiation. So almost we have harvested 200 or 300 liters, almost obviously 50 to 60 grams per 200 or 300 liters, we can get dry biomass. So at the time, the paddle agitation maintained for 14 hours per day. So the paddle agitation, why we have given here is, so we have added three species of microalgae, different microalgae. So we cannot know, we may not know that the parallel agitation give a strength to a particular species. So we have given parallel agitation for 14 hours per day. Again, the 20% is harvested on a regular basis, top up with small quantity of treated seawater to maintain the water level. So here 47 grams per 200 liter per day, we have harvested dry biomass. So once I said on the mixed mass culture, after 6th or 8th day, getting dilution. So the dilution means ketocerasis or isocerasis. These two major microalgae, not growing well in that. So slowly the nanochlorophyll, green algae, unicellular green algae, nanochlorophyll, easily growing well with the there's available nitrogen concentration. And the sixtieth day, you see how this microalgae concentration is in this laser pond. Very thick, the million concentration almost 6 to 8 million per ml concentration were noted with the hemocytometer and using the raceway microalgae production system. So as I said, we have added 3 microalgae. So in that, here species composition change. So isocrysis and heterocrysis species are given high concentration. So after certain period, these two microalgae get arrested and these nanotubules get suited. So these microalgae biomass or harvested biomass were subjected for fatty acid profile analysis. So here 4 different kind of trials were conducted. So we need good PUFA, rich PUFA content microalgae species as a candidate for aquaculture system. So here the PUFA almost 29% of polyunsaturated fatty acids were observed with one particular candidate strain. So that culture will be used to use the inoculum to the aquaculture shrimp aquaculture system. So by controlling these parameters, 5 micron filtered untreated coastal water reservoir tank to develop PUFA rich microalgae in continuous mode culture maintained for a long period. This technology absolutely worked well to produce high liquid content microalgae biomass, and this microalgae culture greatly support us live feed and enrich the nutritional values in shellfishes. Thank you.
Vinit?
Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful presentation.
And thanks for the wonderful and information presentation, Dr. Selva.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, you have used the word lab to land in the title. Of course, you prove your expertise by providing the needed information for the benefit of the researchers at lab and for the end users in the land. And thanks for that detailed presentation. I have seen the chat box continuously. People are coining that word. It's a informative presentation. I'm really happy that you have given such a wonderful talk here.
Thanks a lot, sir.
And in this juncture, I want to inform that in our Center for Ocean Research through Satyabhama University Technology Business Incubator, we have set up an aquaculture facility with the support of Department of Science and Technology, NSTEDB, and Government of India, where we are also having a microalgal facility. And of course, recently, Mrs. Gayatri, who is an active researcher in SUTBA, she have published a paper on the production of lutein from marine chlorella through photobioreactor, as well as she have also reported the ultrasound sound assisted micro extraction also. Both these papers are available in Biomass Conversion and Biorefinery Journal. I'm happy to inform that here in this juncture. And also, I want to say that the Center for Ocean Research is a joint initiative of National Institute of Ocean Technology. And recently, myself as a, and with the scientists of NIOT as well as from Kalpakkam IGCR, we have published a paper on how to improve the production of ketoceras using deep ocean water. So deep ocean is having a rich of NPK ratio, I mean, yes, nitrogen,
sir,
and phosphorus.
Yes,
utilize that, and we have already reported, and that is available at the Asian Coastal and Self Science Journal. I just want to pinpoint all these things because a lot of researchers are being in this forum, and it will be useful for those people. Yes, apart, sir, from this, we are also doing some value addition from the microalgae and microalgae-based byproducts. And we are also welcoming the young entrepreneur as well as other people who want to utilize the SUTBA or a COR facility. You are always welcome to visit our campus. And the fourth thing, it is my basic question for you. What is the merits and demerits in the using of live biomass of algal culture as well as the algal powder?
I mean, using of live culture and dried biomass.
Yeah.
Where we need to use? In aquaculture system?
No, actually I want to know, what is the merits and demerits? In aquaculture system only I'm asking.
For example, so if we use the dried algal dry biomass, we cannot add directly into the water system, shrimp aquaculture water system, isn't it? So if we want to add this dry biomass as a beneficial factor to the shrimp means, definitely we should go for pelletized technology. So okay. The artificial feed now people are using, no, by feed millers. So okay. From them, we have to give a biomass to the people and they can add our biomass as a feed additive in their feed products.
Okay.
Sorry, got my point. So yeah. If we give the dry biomass, so they can add and the direct, that might be very beneficial. It can consume, 100% consume through the pellet.
So actually you said it is not possible to add the dry biomass directly to the shrimp aquaculture pond.
Not so pond, that's what, pelletized feed, artificial feed.
Yeah, only in the form of pellet we can add.
Yes.
So. Yes. Why we have not to add those kind of powder form of that in the water column? Yes. I think your answer will be helpful to the research people.
Yes, sure, sir. Yeah. So if you add, so what happens, the initial stage of larvae, I mean the larvae 1 or 2 or mycozoa, so that time of period we can add these dried biomass. So instead of adding live microalgae, I mean, it's consuming large volume of water or culture system so that we can get the dry biomass and small amount of dry biomass, we can directly add it into the water. So that's what you're trying to say.
Yeah.
So that time, the animal size, the zoomycetes, that time we can give dry biomass to the animals. But the once the animal got zonal stage, it may not be get 100% beneficial.
So it will be cooked in hatchery technology.
Yes, yeah, we can use it as a creative technology. But in culture systems, shrimp culture systems, people are using live culture as spirulina paste. The spirulina paste is available now in market. The harvested spirulina paste can add directly to the pond. So there, the 80% of spirulina will get live and it can work as a live feed into the animals, aquaculture system, shrimp, for the shrimp.
So this kind of pace can be encouraged for the young entrepreneurs. Can work on that and they can come with the other product also.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sure.
Thank you. Anu.
Yes, sir.
Vinit, please.
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir.
Go with the Q&A session.
Thank you for the informative and elaborative presentation, sir.
So first, I would like to unmute Rakesh Jenamani. Rakesh?
Hello?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Good morning, everyone.
Yeah, good morning.
Sir, I have only two questions. First, in the pond culture, there are suddenly the algae control crashes down. So okay. How we should tackle that problem? And what is the first step or immediate action to prevent mass mortality in the fish culture or shrimp culture? And second one, sir, is, what is the role of vertical substrates in the algal control system?
What is the practical difficulties in control system? What's the question? Please give it.
Second question is, what is the role of vertical substrates
vertical systems? Yes.
And the first one is, if suddenly the algal control crashes down, then what is the first step we should take to prevent the mass mortality of shrimp or fish culture?
So that's what was. So in aquaculture system, the once the problems are once something happens, we cannot get rectified, isn't it? So that is, we are playing with very live organisms, very sensitive microorganism, shrimp. See, so the once the water column or water parameters in the water surface water microorganism population get disturbed, so we cannot get retrieved. See, for example, we can say the ones you say microalgae with full bloom, these blooms suddenly get crashed. What we can do? So we cannot do anything. Just we can go for 30 to 50% of water exchange. So already it's happened. So bloom got crashed. So what will happen? So the crashed bloom, crashed microalgae floating, happening daily wise in the pond, surely it will leads for some other parameter fluctuation. So that beginningly we can dewater on the top of the water for 30 to 40%. So after 30 to 40%, so the contaminated, dead microalgae, crashed microalgae will get declined. So once they after declined, so we can go addition of some healthy probiotics of soil or water. So the once the microalgae blooms once get started to start, so again we have to check the water quality and the nutrients, nutritional factors. So for example, nitrate concentration is, so what is the main factors? So the phosphate concentration were reached up, reached to high. So that's the reason these phytoplankton can't survive in the water column and it's died. So these questions should be arised by ourselves. And so based on the result, we should fluctuate the concentration of the nutrients. For example, if you fluctuate the pH, the particular microalgae will get eliminated. So that kind of daily observation should be made on the pond. Then only we can say this might be the control factor, and we can go with these remedies. So without seeing or without following the regular observation, we cannot say any recommendation to the farmers. So that thing on the first question answer, that is, we cannot, there is no remedy for that. So not only we can suit up the culture of good microalgae by addition of this technology, what I had said now. So we can add good concentration of good large volume microalgae culture, we can add into the pond so that the crashed microalgae once decant, this added microalgae may get suit up and the water column surface will be get cleared. So that is one thing. And the next question, please come on second. So what is the reason for white pigs disease? Are you asking that?
Just a minute, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir, please.
Sir, the second one is, what is the role of vertical substrates? Means the green shed net or something like that we are using in the shrimp farm to tackle the algae in the surface of that substrate, so that the shrimp or fish, they eat that feed, or we can control them throughout the pond.
So how can I am understanding your question is, the bloom occurred, shrimp may eat like that, you are asking, or what? I'm not
clear. Yes, sir.
Yes, obviously, all the microalgae consumed, all the microalgae will consume all the phytoplanktons. But in the case of filamentous microalgae, it's like a blue green algae with lengthy cell size. So it may not be usable. So in my presentation, I have said that. So the once the these filamentous occurred in the water surface, sunlight may not be fall into the bottom of the pond. The once the sunlight controlled to fall into the bottom, all the bottom pollutants will not get any oxidation. So the oxidation should happen means automatically, sunlight should fall onto the bottom. Then only all the gases or some other organic materials get evaporate oxidation by adding our probiotics or something else like a chemicals. Then only we can maintain the good atmosphere of the pond bottom.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir.
So next, I would like to unmute Dr. Durga Prasad Behera. Sir, you can continue, sir. Dr. Durga Prasad.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Please continue, sir. Dr. Durga Prasad. Sir, I think his connectivity is...
Okay. No issue.
There is the one question from Dr. L. Stanley Abraham, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Sir, is there? Ask him to...
His mic is not working, it seems.
Okay.
So he has posted the question in the chat. He is thanking you, sir, for your detailed and informative presentation. And he's telling that I want to clarify from the farmer side that how to distinguish toxic algal bloom from live feed algae.
So toxic algae, so we can say one group that is called dinoflagellates. That is the only toxic algae. And as well as some of the blue-green algae, Trichodesmium, Lingpia, also will give some cell poisons, substance. So these substance, what happens, it occurs into the heptapancreas of the animal. So these cell poisons, which is released from the dinoflagellates or blue-green algae, will accumulate into the heptapancreas of the shrimp. Then the shrimp heptapancreas active will suppress it or controlled. So then the digestion tract will not be properly work, and the feeded pellets will not be digested good. So this is the flow through, the chance to get the animal weakness, as well as these animals also to affected with highly pathogenic bacteria into the gut flora. So this is the two major things, one cyanobacteria and blue-green algae cyanobacteria, and another one is dinoflagellates. Two things are major important phytoplanktons, the microalgae in the Western system. It will surely disturb the culture system. So our farmers, what they will do, so the brown tea color, brown, very thick brown tea color, water will give a very good bloom, especially for dinoflagellates. So in the time, if we observed weekly observation made in the water column, especially for the dinoflagellate, if we found the concentration, cell concentration of dinoflagellate get increased, immediately we can go for some BKC like sanitizer, a medium doses of sanitizers, so that we can eliminate that one. So far, dinoflagellates and the blue-green algae in water culture system, definitely one day it will collapse the animal health system.
Thank you, sir.
So next, I would like to unmute Dr. N. Selvakumar.
Yes.
Dr. N. Selvakumar, you can unmute yourself and... Sir, I... Dr. N. Selvakumar?
Yes. Sorry.
Yes.
Hello. Sir, thanks for your informative session.
Welcome, sir.
I have two questions. First question is, for open culture system, yes, after shrimp harvesting, we'll get pure culture or mixed culture biomass from pond? If mixed culture, how we can use it as products, like in nutraceutical or something else? Can you explain, sir?
Boss, here one thing.
Yes.
So from the mixed culture, for nutraceutical purpose or some other, a medicinal value purpose, we cannot use it. Why I'm saying? So once you harvested the shrimp in pond, water column will be free, you're saying. So after that, after doing anything, as I did, the same microalgae, which is already present in the water, it should rise. So that, likewise you're asking. So that biomass we can get harvest, but while going for a harvest, the concentration of the microalgae should be minimum 0.3 grams per liter concentration. Otherwise, all the process will leads to economical loss. So, for example, even though if you make with multi-population microalgae, you are obtaining at least 1 kg of dry biomass out of it. So many microalgae are there. So in this many microalgae, we can use that polyunsaturated fatty acid or lipid extraction we can use. Other than lipid profile, biochemical composition, especially the biochemical composition, all automatically will give changes. So for example, gyrosigma or rhizia. So these both two microalgae will give different concentration of the protein values, isn't it? So biotic compounds of the bioactive composition of bioactive compound of the these two microalgae having a different different concentration or different components. So what I am saying is, for example, we can use this microalgae for aquaculture purpose, well and good. If we are going some nutritional nutritional purpose, it will give some classes. These micro pathogenic microorganism present in the same water, isn't it? Culture almost 4 months or 3 months, culture successfully harvest shrimp or harvested. So in that culture, obviously the pathogenic bacteria will be there.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So you cannot use that particular biomass for some bioactive component extraction.
For feed formulation, we can use it, right?
Yes, feed formulations, you can use it.
Sir, one more question. Yes. Which microalgae species causes a shrimp gill choking problem and how to prevent it?
Yes, gill choking problem. See, what I'm expecting to say is, so the microalgae, so gill choking at the times, dinoflagellates and the blue green algae, yes, both we can say. So not even diatoms. So that also block the gills, and the gill soaking will happen. So not only microalgae, some pathogenic microorganisms also playing in this role. So especially not alone the microalgae, the gill soak problem is not coming. So some pathogenic bacteria also playing a role.
So how to avoid the gill choking problem during the cultures? Time.
Proper water management only, boss. See, we all are experts. So I'm also experts, are also everyone expert. We are handling the ponds by visiting weekly once or 10 days once. We can control the system? Never. We cannot control. So even the very big directors or some very expert as committee members, whoever it is. So the person who is regularly having observation on the pond, they can only control the parameters. By visiting like a weekly once or 10 days once, it will not work out. So you are asking how we can control this gill soaking. So proper sanitizing we have to take, under the proper probiotic we have to give, the proper water applications to maintain the good bloom of microalgae. It's very, very important. If you maintain the pathogenic free atmosphere condition, you can avoid not only the gill soak and all the problems. So the broodstock itself or PL itself, if something happens with some viral disease or bacterial diseases, we cannot do anything. So the ones, even though nowadays the PCR test we have conducted in quarantine centers, that quarantine centers animal get results, and that particular tested animals are inoculated into the pond. So even though within 20 or 30 days, today we are visibly we are seeing white Pekka's disease in within the 20 days. So even 5 to 10 days also white spot disease syndromes are occurred in the ponds. So everything, our home should be good. Home nothing but the pond. The pond atmosphere should be pollutant free. Then only we can minimize the disease systems or minimize the some other contaminations.
Thank you, Dr. Silva. We can stop the question answer session here because the time is almost 11:30. Please share your contact address in the screen so that other participants who want to interact with to you, they can directly interact to you.
Yes, sir.
Can you? Yeah.
Yes, please. Sir. Coming. So email ID is biosilva@gmail.com and mobile number 9191606810, WhatsApp enabled. So whoever need any aquaculture oriented help or
help, worries, you can call or contact Dr. P. Silva Kumar. And I see a lot of flashing words. What about the feedback form? The feedback form will be shared to you in the afternoon session, where there will be a validatory program and a director research of Satyabhama Institute of Science and Technology. She will be answered in there. The time it will be shared. Please join us in the afternoon session also. Anu, you can go with the instruction.
So regarding feedback form, as sir said, it will be given in the afternoon session, in the validatory function by the director, ma'am. And the topic for the afternoon session is on aquaculture career and opportunities. The talk will be given by Dr. M. Vijay. So kindly join the afternoon session and get benefited. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Selva.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thanks a lot. Thank you, Anu, and thank you, Vinit, and thank you for the
pleasure, all. Sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.